The ratification of the Servicemen's Readjustment Act, commonly known as the GI Bill, was an unprecedented achievement for the United States. Never before had a social policy attempted to rehabilitate veterans into American society in such a unique manner. The GI Bill allowed millions of veterans to return to school, purchase homes, and start new careers. While the plethora of new opportunities awaiting veterans after World War II represents one of America's greatest social triumphs, the disparity between the opportunities of white America and black America represents one of this nation's greatest tragedies. The widespread racism rampant in the American South allowed for de jure discrimination against African American veterans. While the massive triumphs of the GI Bill cannot be ignored, the inability of black GIs to effectively use their GI Bill benefits can in many ways be cited for the ever-expanding racial wealth gap in modern-day America. On July 28, 1932, Major George Patton began his initial march toward roughly 37,000 World War I veterans. Major Patton was tasked with dispelling the aggravated coalition, formerly known as the Bonus Army, out of D.C. where they were protesting. Suffering from the struggles of the Great Depression, Americans witnessed as Army veterans demanding payment for their services in World War I clashed with current military personnel. For the sitting president, President Herbert Hoover, the rise of the Bonus Army and the violence that erupted thereafter was politically debilitating. So much so that his successor, President Franklin D. Roosevelt, campaigned on supporting veterans like never before.
All of these rights spell security. And after this war is won, we must be prepared to move forward in the implementation of these rights to new goals of human happiness and well-being. For unless there is security here at home, there cannot be lasting peace in the world.
President Roosevelt's support came in the form of the Servicemen's Readjustment Act of 1944, also known as the GI Bill, signed into law on June 22, 1944. The GI Bill was written first by Harry W. Cumary, the Republican National Committee Chairman, and U.S. Senator Ernest McFarland. The benefits of the GI Bill aimed to improve the economic conditions for veterans by offering otherwise difficult or unavailable opportunities. The bill's first benefit allowed the Veterans Administration to provide low-interest home, farm, and business loans. The bill's second component allowed unemployed veterans to receive assistance based upon the 52-20 clause. For 52 weeks, a veteran would receive $20 a week while they were seeking work. The bill's third provision required the United States Employment Service to assist veterans in finding jobs catered to the skills they developed prior to or during military service. Lastly, the final provision paid for a veteran's education or vocational training for up to 4 full years. Future scholars would hail the GI Bill as the Great Democratizer and America's greatest single piece of social legislation. The 7.8 million World War II veterans who used their benefits to complete a degree or vocational training earned an average of $10,000 to $15,000 more annually than those that did not. Also, their increased earnings generated tax revenues 8 to 10 times greater than the total cost of the program. But shrouded in one of America's greatest policy triumphs is one of America's most detrimental tragedies. The rampant racism in the VA, combined with the underfunding and scarcity of HBCUs, led to a vast disparity in the use of GI Bill benefits between white and black veterans.
So the implementation of it was great. The challenge was that it did not address the systemic racism and discrimination in the country at the time.
While the intention of the GI Bill may have been to improve the socioeconomic status of veterans both white and black, the new VA mortgage policy instead led to the beginning of federally funded housing discrimination. In the Supreme Court decision, Buchanan v. Warley, it was declared unconstitutional for locally elected officials to uphold recently established racial zones in which African Americans specifically were to reside. It was reasoned that because locally elected officials were governmental representatives under the 14th Amendment, it was an infringement of property rights based upon race. However, The Buchanan v. Wiley decision did imply that it was legally justified to make racially restrictive covenants in property deeds, since restrictive covenants were signed by individual property owners, and their racial discrimination did not constitute governmental action. The Supreme Court upheld this view in the 1926 Corvin v. Buckley decision. Like wildfire, racially restrictive covenants spread through the United States, restricting access to homes for African Americans.
Some of the GI Bill benefits were supervised by state agencies, and those state agencies discriminated against African Americans, denying them benefits related to unemployment insurance, housing loans, business loans, and so on.
It were these racially restrictive covenants that the VA did not oppose for the sake of veterans' quality of life, but instead embraced. Not only did the VA hinder African Americans from areas where restrictive covenants were in place, but the VA also insured mortgages on homes with racially restrictive covenants. In other words, the VA was both approving white veterans to live in white-only neighborhoods while barring African Americans from living in the same neighborhoods, thereby insinuating the racist land policies they declared to protect African Americans from. It would not be till May 1948, well after many African American World War II veterans would attempt to utilize their GI Bill benefits for home loans, that Shelley v. Kramer and Heard v. Hodge would outlaw the enforcement of racially restrictive clauses in property deeds. But the damage had already been done. Local VA facilities across the United States had successfully barred black veterans from particular homes, leading to the ghettoization of minority veterans and their dependents. In 1947, a survey by historical scholar Howard Johnson found that despite African Americans making up a third of one southern state's population, of the 17,000 VA workers there, only 7 were black. The lack of representation of African Americans is not only important when understanding how the VA facilitated housing discrimination, but also important in understanding how widespread racism prevented African American veterans from pursuing a college education.
So, by 1955, they estimated that between 100,000 and 50,000 black GIs who had the government backing were turned away from historically black colleges and universities because they did not have the capacity to grow at the rate necessary to admit these guys.
By 1946, of the estimated 100,000 black veterans eligible to attend college under the GI Bill, only a fifth gained admittance. This was due to both the overcrowding and underfunding of HBCUs and the discriminatory admissions policies barring black veterans from pursuing an education elsewhere. Because 79% of the black population was concentrated in the South, in which educational segregation was required by law, many African Americans were forced to attend HBCUs, and many of these HBCUs were underfunded at best. Of all the HBCUs, only 5% were accredited by the Association of American Universities. None had an accredited engineering program, none had a doctoral program, and only 7 institutions had any graduate programs. On top of that, half of the HBCUs had fewer than 250 students. As an African American veteran, pursuing a college education was extremely difficult. Having to overcome discriminatory admissions processes, racist VA officials, and highly restrictive HBCU opportunities, it is extraordinary that many African Americans received an education through the GI Bill at all. The Servicemen's Readjustment Act of 1944 was one of America's greatest political triumphs in the post-war era. Nearly 8 million Americans would benefit from the GI Bill and revitalize the American educational and economic landscape in the process. But embedded in one of America's greatest achievements was one of America's worst deficiencies: the federal government's inability to effectively protect African American veterans from housing discrimination and uphold black veterans' access to college education led to one of America's most significant disparities and has facilitated the creation of racial income inequality prevalent in modern American society. History shows that the federal government and America as a whole still viewed those same black veterans as both uneducated and unwelcome.